Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as we gather here to give thanks and pray for these who are here to be ordained, we thank you for the joy of being able to do so, of raising up men and women that we love and support. So glad, O Lord, for what you are doing in their lives, and as a result, in the life of this church, your diocese. And so, Lord, as we gather together in your name and draw near to that moment when prayers are offered and hearts are changed, we do say, speak, Lord, your servants are listening. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, that we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I was coming around, walking through the church before the ordination began, as I sometimes do, and I was a little preoccupied, thinking about things, praying about the service. And I came up the aisle, and as I began to come around the aisle, and I have her permission to tell the story, Marla Glover from St. Mark said, "Hello, Father Brewer." And then she went, "Oh, no, I meant Bishop Brewer." She was all embarrassed. And I said, "Oh, Marla, that's okay." I said, "I'm still a priest. All of the ordinations stick. They never go away." And that's a part of what I want to say to you. These ordinations stick. They don't go away. You are always in the mercy of God. No matter what happens to you for the rest of your life, even if you're ordained a priest or even if you're ordained a bishop, you're still a deacon. That is something that God has placed within you, and he has committed to making sure that that never goes away. That's his pledge to you. I say that because all ordinations, at least for me, are an opportunity for me to remind myself of what is powerfully and personally true in each of these occasions. And the Lord has a wonderful way, since he knows that I preach to myself as much as anybody else, of reminding me of the things that somehow slip off the radar. In some ways, you all, as called to be servants, really are called, in fact, to a ministry that feels almost always somewhat inconvenient. Because you see, to be a servant is, in fact, to make a commitment to no longer live life on your terms. As Paul says very graphically, we commend ourselves, we commend Jesus Christ to you as Lord, and ourselves, what, as your slaves, your servants' sake. Which means, what do you need? How can I help? How can I serve? Which means what we're asking Jesus to do is actually, by the Holy Spirit, work in us a kind of inner alertness to what we should say, how we can step in, ways that we can be helpful. It actually doesn't matter a lot. I still have to get used to this. That literally, no matter what I have on my list for the day, in my calling, you see, as a deacon in the church of God, anything can happen. And when that happens, my responsibility is to step up, be available, see what it is that I might be able to do. It's important because, in fact, to have that kind of servant's heart requires a certain level of intentionality, training, as it were. Because, you see, what we want is that we want training on how to lead. That's somewhat different than training in learning how to serve. You see, to lead is to take command. It's to step out in a way that causes other people to follow behind you, to be able to speak with a level of authority that causes other people to sit up and take notice. But honestly, the integrity of that leadership has to be grounded in a felt commitment, not just something inside of you, in a felt commitment that they trust you, and you trust them. And because that's so, they know that when you speak, they are willing, and you are willing to lead, and they are willing to follow, because they already know the servant's heart that God has placed within you. And if that's not evident, at best, you're a dictator with a clergy collar, which is honestly the worst kind. We know people like that, right? And so we're in call to something really very different, and something, honestly, that is exceedingly difficult. It's easy to serve when things are going the way you want them to. When they're not, that's a totally different matter. And you see, that's the context in which this commandment that Jesus gives in the Gospel of Luke is given. I mean, that whole chapter is nothing but controversy, upheaval, backbiting, wrangling. Who's going to be the greatest and who's not? Here we are literally at the very Last Supper. Jesus is consecrating bread and wine. This is my body. They should all be basically all on their faces in awe. Instead, did you see who got the best seat tonight? In other words, it's so profoundly and even painfully human. And of course, Jesus is aware that this is not just a night to share a meal. This is the night for the arrest. Everything in the worst possible way and in the most glorious way is about to happen in the next few days. And so it is in the midst of all of this interior and exterior upheaval, anxiety, dread, anticipated joy, wrangling back and forth, that Jesus looks at his disciples and says, here's how kings operate. This is what benefactors do. It is not to be this way among you. In other words, at the time, not when they're on a grassy knoll, looking at sheep nuzzling each other, giving them this kind of very kind, thoughtful word, the context robs the passage entirely from any sort of sappy sentimentality, because servanthood is gritty. Servanthood asks things of you that you wish, in fact, that it did not. Servanthood asks you to step in and get on your knees and wash feet with the people that you least likely want to be with, much less touch their feet, even metaphorically speaking. And because that's the case, there's a kind of death that happens, and it's meant to be that way. You know, Bonhoeffer's famous line, when Jesus Christ calls a man, he calls him to come and die. It is exactly within the context of servanthood that that actually winds up being expressed literally as a way of life, where you're learning how to die to the necessity of personal convenience, when you're learning how to die to the desire just to hang out with people who like you, whether you're to call to die to live in places that could cause genuine financial straits in the life of you and your family, and therefore the desire to somehow live a comfortable life becomes more and more remote. I mean, it's not, let me give you a secret. I don't have a comfortable life. I make an okay salary. But literally, in your heart of hearts, with the burdens of what you bear, in the constant rise and fall of crises after crises, the things that are going on, it's anything but comfortable, but it is the place of service to which the calling has been manifested. And that's true for you, and where you learn it is now. And in fact, given the fact that you've already said yes to the call of a deacon, my hunch is that God has already been at work in you, showing you places in your life that you wish weren't there, where you are, in fact, more self-centered than you could ever imagine that you actually were, and where all of a sudden you're finding yourself saying things that, gosh, did I really mean it when I said that? In a way that really is causing you to feel actually chastened by the Holy Spirit, even as the Holy Spirit invites you into a deeper place of self-sacrifice, and as a result, holiness. For as it says in Hebrews, The Lord chastens those whom he loves, that we might partake in his holiness. This is not an easy life. Just the opposite. It is the method that God has chosen, think about this, to work in you the kind of I am crucified with Christ life. In other words, the venue for God's chastening work, the venue for God teaching you how to serve in the inconvenient places, the avenue by which that happens is that to which you are now about to say yes. Different people have different paths into this path of transformation and holiness. But if you're living in the grace of God, no one escapes it. It's just the way that God chooses, as it were, to manifest it in your life. But lest you get the idea that somehow what you're being invited to is a sort of horrible sort of death, I also want to reassure you that the invitation to serve produces in you the opportunity to get a front row seat to see God at work. You will see miracles that others in their own self-preoccupation will never really notice. You will hear the tender heart of God speaking to you, as somehow something begins to happen in you to give you the capacity to see and serve an individual that you'd actually rather not be with. And yet what God is doing is literally creating within you the space to be able to do that willingly and know that he's at work in this process. Because sometimes you know, you have to pray, Lord, I know you love this person very much. I can't see it. Help me, Lord, to see what you see that you find so extraordinarily lovable. And the glory of it is that often that happens. It can be just the little flash of sadness in the eyes, a certain movement or the way they speak that opens a door that allows you to see something about it. It's called discernment that you never actually would have noticed otherwise, that enlarges your heart, that in fact allows you to be uncommonly generous. You can only do this if you know that God has been the one who's called you to do it. Particularly with everything in our culture, and often everything in our church says that if you're really doing well, you're living a life of ease, or at least certainly convenience, if not ease. And this is not that. But it is worth it, because uncommon servanthood is the fruit of uncommon grace. And uncommon grace yields the intimacy of the presence of God, the insights into his word, times in prayer that you could never imagine, in a way that causes your heart to be changed if you're willing to live into the grace that he gives you. I'd rather have that than anything. So, you're going to be troublemakers. You're going to be extraordinarily generous. You're going to be misunderstood. You're going to have to learn how to turn the other cheek and forgive, even when you feel like it's not warranted, just because Jesus says so. You're going to have the capacity to see into hearts and look at circumstances in a way that allows you to be able to move forward, because God is showing you exactly what to do. All of that and more is yours as you continue to say yes to him. To him. Because in the end, you're his deacon. You're under his leadership and authority. It is to him to whom you are answerable, and is also to him that you owe all that you know about the love and the mercy and the power of God. So I'm really excited. I really am, because I look forward to seeing what God is going to do in and through you. Your coming is actually a gift to the church. It's an expansion of the ministry of Christ in our midst. You will, by virtue of the diaconal call, blaze new trails, open doors that we don't presently see, cause us to look at people differently and pay more attention to the needs of the world than we would normally, because you're the one speaking up and even saying the inconvenient things that the rest of us would rather not hear. So, as your bishop, go for it. Make the time to pray, be built up in the Holy Spirit, and begin to give and see what God will do. We need you. The temptation to complacency is far too great. And we all wrestle with the same things to go easily for us. So, it is an inconvenient ministry to which you are called, but more necessary than you will ever imagine. Step up, and let's see what God will do. Amen.